Hello, everybody. It is 10 p.m. Central Time on April 4th, 2017. Hope you're doing good. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet. And we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch. So if you're new here, welcome in. It looks like we've got about 530 or 40 people between YouTube and Twitch and Facebook and my website again. So it's just good to see everybody back in. And guys, it's been a busy couple days. It's been pretty hefty in activity. And this today holds true, just like it was over the past couple days. And we'll start over here in the West Pacific with our activity that broke out. And just as expected, a 5.0, 4.9, they ultimately went with up to 5.5, was detected right in the middle of our silent zone here in eastern Papua New Guinea. And we talked about the border of eastern Papua New Guinea and the Solomon Islands last night in last night's update. And it's between a 5 and 5.5. And you guys know the USGS does this half magnitude downgrade thing. And just to prove this to you, I'll take you over and show you the display capture on the page. Now, we're over here on the USGS site right now. And let's go to the detail page. Now, look on the list here. I mean, you know, we've got our fours, and then we go up into fives. And several stations showing 5.3, 5.5, 5.2. And then they work in a three to bring it down. But, you know, again, multiple, enough fives on the list, 5.4, 5.0, enough fives for me to think that it's more like a 5 and that they really did another one of these downgrade things. So there's the earthquake we were looking for right at the center. Additionally, Guam and North Philippines, just south of Taiwan, were hit. And you may remember we issued a warning near Guam. Well, look, there's the tiny island of Guam and a 5.3 hit there. Similar sized earthquake, 5.2, 5.1. If you add those together, that equals 5.3. Struck right here at where our bend in the plate boundary is. So you see, I was looking here, by the way. I was looking where the two arrows come together, and it's just to the south, and I will consider that an earthquake forecast hit since it's the exact matching magnitude, and it's equidistantly spaced on both sides, as we would expect. Then, up to the north, a new deep earthquake has occurred right on our letter D. The reason the letter D is there is because deep earthquakes occur there often. And this primes the pump, or it lets us know that something's coming very soon for the coast of Japan. Usually at least one magnitude larger would be 5.2. Two magnitude larger would be 6.2. And at this point, with the deep earthquake there and the fives pushing in from the south, it could easily go above 6. Where? Most likely right up here where our arrows come together. You see where all these arrows come together? It's really just a small section, but it's the main section we all know about from past activity. Now, we're not looking for a megaquake. We're not looking for anything like that. It would top out in the 6 range. Why? Because of the deep 4 and the 5s pushing up from the south. If you add the 5.3 plus this 5.2 and 5.1, we get to 5.5 to 5.6 already. Does that make sense? So you add up the two earthquakes to the south, and they're pushing north, and now a new push from up underneath coming up and pushing upwards and outwards towards the surface. Okay, so that's what happened today over here in the West Pacific. Down in New Zealand, we had a little bit of different of a story take place. And let me show you the larger earthquakes that broke out. Now, last night we talked about this, the 4.3, technically hitting a day and a half ago. Let's get that off there and look what struck since. So since then, we had the previous earthquake, 4.3. Now take a look at it, guys. We have a bunch of threes that spread all the way across the island, going down to the south, central, and north. And they're all pretty much the same size. 3.5, 3.5, 3.2, 3.3. All in a few hours' time spreading across the island. This is what I would call compensation movement, spreading down to the south. Now, time on this, let's get the time. I mean, we'll see if it's a clear progression or do they bounce around. So let's go with UTC time since it'll be easier to tell. So 14:17 UTC down to the south. 7 UTC. 16:09. 14:59. Let's make sure these are all on the same day. Yep. All right. Well, the way I'm looking at it here, guys, we're looking at 2 a.m. first with the 3.5, then 11.09 a.m. Okay, so it would go this one first, the 3.5 at the central part of the island, then this one at 9.17 a.m. New Zealand time. So it takes 6 hours, you know, 6 or 7 hours for it to travel to the south. Then another one strikes at 11 New Zealand time, 11 a.m. Let's make sure about that. Hold on. I'm waiting for this to refresh. I want to make sure on this progression. 11 a.m. And then to the north, 9:59 a.m. So it's bouncing around. It's doing the bounce thing. Central south, central north. Central south, central north. That's what's going on there. That's interesting. I'm glad I did that real time for you guys to see how it's done. You have to look at the time, see how it's happening. So this is exactly what we would expect. First, the central part of the island gets hit. Then the north part of the island gets hit. Then the central part of the island gets hit. Then the south part of the island gets hit. Back and forth. One after the other. Leaping over each other and all the same magnitude. Now, why is it only threes this time? Well, we may be getting off lucky and the pressure is expending itself with smaller swarms. See all these ones and twos that are mixed in with this, maybe relieving some of that pressure. I'd also like to point out to my Australian viewers, look what's going on right now, guys. Hey, Australia, you guys normally aren't in the forecast, and I know I've got a lot of viewers down under. We had the 4.0 that struck at the central part of Australia, just west of Uluru or Ayers Rock. And I told you guys, it pushes up on the underside of Australia like a circus top, so pushing up that main pole underneath the circus tent. And then we see compensation happen on the outside perimeter, and look what hit today. And right down where we told you, Perth and down here in south part, southeast Australia, would move next. And that's exactly what happened, east of Perth and east on the southeast coast of Australia, both moving similar-sized earthquakes. So the four at the center, maybe that, is that still on the... I guess I would have to turn on the Australian feed. Just imagine a four right here in the middle between these two. That's pretty much where it was, like right in here. So the four there, and then it pushed up on both sides. Isn't that wild? So now you know what to expect. When you have deep earthquakes, a series of deep earthquakes to your north, it usually pushes up first on the underside of the central part of Australia, then followed by movement around the perimeters. Amazing stuff that's going on here. So what's going to happen here? Well, down in New Zealand, down in Australia, you guys are victims of the deep earthquakes to your north. And a new deep earthquake today means a new round of activity is coming into New Zealand over the next day and a half to 2 days. How big? Most likely in the 4 to 4.5 range. Probably the same size as this deep earthquake that's right here. However, we're still looking for a 5.0 to compensate off of Taupo. That may disappear. That 5 may go away with the smaller swarms that are striking. I would like to point out Taupo supervolcano that was experiencing the massive swarm. Now look at it. It's barely a stack, which is good news. But just as expected, after the Taupo swarm stopped, now we're seeing the South Island pick up. So this was absorbing the pressure that was coming in from the north off this last round of deep earthquakes. That's what pushed Taupo's magma chamber up and caused this swarm. But now that that's stopped, it's allowing for pressure to escape across the plate again, or at least the plate boundary, and the central part of New Zealand is going to get hit again. Just south of the plate boundary, south of Wellington, where the other four struck. Let's show you where that is here. Hold on. Let's get all the others off here. There it is. So just southwest of this location, and I'll say like 20, 30, maybe 50 miles southwest, interior to the mountains is where we should see it. I mean, that's pretty much the only location I could see it happening. Other than that, if the compensation doesn't take place, then it's going to be expended by the swarm. I mean, it's not going to disappear. The energy is not just going to go away. We're seeing swarms pick up to the south. We're going to hope it stays underneath 5, but a new 4.4 has just struck. I don't know if that's going to accumulate on top of the 5 that I'm expecting, or if that 5 is being drawn away right now with all those 3s, and that this 4 is going to lead to a new mid-range 4. So as it stands right now, let's just put it for the 4.5 off the new deep earthquake, and we'll watch separately for that 5 compensation off Taupo that may or may not occur. What's the difference between a 4.5 and a 5? Half magnitude. a difference in power, I mean, we're talking about a shake or a harder shake. I mean, it's not going to be that big of a deal. You guys are used to this stuff, and it's not that populated out there in the mountain range, by the way. Won't cause landslides, won't cause any craziness like that. Now, let's talk about, well, where should we talk about next? Let's talk about Southern Africa. We talked about this yesterday. Very rare 7.0 earthquake struck in Botswana, and or 6.5 is what they went with. However, one of my viewers contacted me and told me that the two earthquakes that struck, while one is a diamond mine technically nearby, that the world's deepest gold mine is at the location as well. So the world's deepest gold mine, well, this is far below the world's deepest gold mine. We're talking at 10, 11, 12, 13 kilometers deep. And the deepest gold mine might go down a couple kilometers. So it's down below the gold mine. But as we know, these veins of gold come up through the crust and off of old magma chambers that are just ancient. Maybe even spots where the mantle has, or not the mantle, the asthenosphere has allowed for spots to come up into the plate up several thousand feet, which comes up into kilometers down below the surface. So that's how they're able to mine this stuff far down below. That's where the veins of gold come from. And if there's veins of gold in there and other precious metals, and it's ancient volcanic, it's also the X marks the spot just to the north, which is part of a huge volcanic chain. This is, you know, I don't know how many times, I may have shown this in the past, but let me just show it to you again. So we're down here at Southern Africa, here's Botswana, and then we go up to the north through Zimbabwe and Malawi and Zambia. And there's many volcanoes in here, and the Smithsonian only has a few of them marked. And I'll show a few of them to you. Okay, they just look like mountains, really. I mean, if you look at these, but if you read the description on each one, ancient calderas, and we'll zoom in and show it to you. Ancient. So they haven't erupted in a very, very long time. Look how they're covered in trees. And by the way, trees are attracted to these nitrogen-rich lava flows. The lava flows are high in nitrogen, and so trees can find their way into the crevice, and that's why we get tree-covered lava flows in areas that are somewhat more arid. If you guys wondered, like in California or in Arizona, why those trees flock to those old volcanoes and those old flows, it's because it traps water. Here's one that has a more definitive crater, a larger blast caldera, but again, ancient, and that's Ngozi. So these are pretty far to the north, right? Well, if you look down to the south, you're going to find more. They're just not Smithsonian studied and marked. So we have more down here. Okay, they're the same shape, the same everything. They're just not studied. Nobody has any place marks on them at all. Now, maybe that's just because of the remote location. Maybe it's because somebody needs to get out there and study. But I would venture a good guess that they probably exist on both sides of the fracture here, which brings us down into Mozambique and then over to the west, following the edge of the craton. I mean, I'm seeing so many different formations to me that, you know, resemble something of ancient volcanism. But if we're talking about thousands of feet down below, there's no way to really know. All we know is that the X marks the spot. We put it over this location because this is a termination point for earthquakes. It just so happens that the antipodal point of this location right here brings us out north of Hawaii. And yesterday, there was that mystery earthquake. Some people tried to say it didn't occur. Other people tried to say it was just a reverberation off the earthquake over in Africa. Either is possible. I would also say it's possible that the earthquake occurred. All three are possible. But look what happened today. As if we needed any more signs that something did occur yesterday, look what happened due north, and I mean exactly due north, because the earthquake that supposedly struck right here in between these two sets of islands. That up to the north, we had a massive increase in activity occur across the Aleutian Island chain in Alaska. This brings me into our volcanic eruption reports. Check this out, guys. As if we needed any more signs that the increase was definitely spreading out, we have new volcanoes on the list. We talked about Santa Guido and Turrialba. Well, we also have a couple on the list like Sakurajima over and over again. Okay, it's been replaced. Also, up at the Kamchatka Peninsula, going through the roof at Shivalush and Kluchevskoy, back-to-back. Kambalny, also on the list. Ebu, this is all today. Kluchevskoy, so let's show you where these are. Kluchevskoy and Shivalush and Kambalny are all right here. from where the letter V is, down to this circular splotch of a mountain range, and then all the way down here at the south tip of Kamchatka. All three volcanoes sending off noteworthy blasts. And we haven't had an earthquake there today, but we have had earthquakes over to the east. And we had our big one yesterday out here somewhere in the ocean that the USGS chose not to report. Also, Sakurajima volcano here at the Kyushu Peninsula in South Japan, where the letter V is, erupting. Tsunamis-jima stopped erupting, replaced by Sakurajima. Further to the south, Dukono erupting again, in case you guys didn't know, and Ibu erupting again. So Dukono and Ibu. What else do we have on the list over here in the West Pacific? I think that's it. Dukono, Ibu. Yeah, that's it. So we have our cluster spots, and it's up to the north, central, and south, spread out evenly across the western part of the plate. We have seen a lack of eruptions across Vanuatu, and we've seen a lack of eruptions over at Cinnabung on both sides of this. On both sides of what? On both sides of the deep earthquakes that have happened over the past couple days, which are raised high off the globe. So on both sides of the deep earthquakes, the eruptions have stopped, which means there's a building seismic threat on both sides of the deep earthquakes. And that's going to carry on for the next 2 to 3 days. Now, the seismic increase should see at least a half magnitude increase on where we are right now, on all locations. And that's pretty easy to determine. So each location being hit by fives to mid-range fives, that's about to go up from where we see fives, we're going to see mid-range fives. And where we see mid-range fives right now, we're going to see sixes to the north. It's that simple. We find our silent points. Now let me explain something to new viewers. Long-time viewers, you hear this every night, but new viewers, the way you forecast, it's somewhat simple. Even a kid can understand this. We find our silent point over the last 48 hours where there haven't been any earthquakes. And we find the middle point of that silent point between the two or three earthquakes. And that middle point tends to be the spot to be hit next. And you add up the earthquakes on all sides, and it totals the amount to strike the fulcrum point, the middle of the silent zone, usually within a few days. That's how we were able to determine a five to mid-range five would be striking here. And it's going to go larger, by the way. It could have gone up to six, which is what we were saying it would top out at. And I showed you the list. You saw it goes up to mid-range five. So it's well within the expected half magnitude range that I try to get my forecast down to. Well, we now have a new silent zone on both sides of this, which means there's two new earthquakes that are going to strike. One of these is a deep earthquake. The deep earthquakes add more punch from up underneath. And if there's more pressure coming up from underneath, that means there's going to be a bigger earthquake striking in between these two earthquakes that we see here. So a deep 4.4 can cause a shallow 5.4 to 6.4. Now, if we just add the 4.4 together with the 4.9, we're already totaling a 5.0 energy, not counting that it's a deep earthquake. But just take it up one more point, and that gets us to 5.8, 5.9, 6.0, which means there's a 6.0 potential to strike between our letter D and our other earthquake to the west at eastern Papua New Guinea, halfway point. Halfway point as the arrows go, not as the crow flies. So we have to actually kind of go down around the bend a little bit here, come up around the triangular bend and go over to the west. And that takes us right down back into the area north of Tonga. So take a look at it. You can see it. It's pretty obvious. Halfway point between the two earthquakes. Next 2 days should be hit by a larger earthquake than the 4.4 for certain. And most likely larger than the 4.9, which takes us up at least into the mid-range 5 level. The other silent zone over to the west brings us right down into central Papua New Guinea. Halfway point between these two sets of earthquakes. And you can add in the earthquake to the north since it has a connecting arrow. See how we have, actually there's two connecting arrows into the area. We have to add these earthquakes to the north. And if we add the earthquakes to the north, let's do that. 5.2 plus a 5.1 is a 5.3. Plus a 4.8 equals a 5.4. Plus a 4.6 equals a 5.4.5, let's say. And then add in the 5.3 over on the other side, and we're going up to 5.5, maybe 5.6. Let's round it up. We'll take it all, if you add in all the other smaller points on it, 5.6. So we have 5.6 energy to the north. Down to the south, we have a 4.4 on one side and a 4.9 or a 5.0 on the other. Well, that's going to take us up to 5.7, 5.8. So that puts us at a potential of a 5.8 to be striking on North Papua New Guinea at the central fulcrum point within the next 2 days, maybe 3 days tops. 48 to 72 hours is what the usual turnaround time is for these silent zones to be struck. Now, if new volcanic eruptions step in and we start seeing multiple new eruptions, that will relieve some of the pressure. That's the only wild card in any of this. As we go further to the west, we have another silent zone. This one's down in southern Indonesia. It's pretty obvious. It's between the two sets of fours. There's only one arrow that we have to be concerned about. So we add up the two fours, and one of these is a deep earthquake, which means we could go up to, again, like I said, 5.5. One magnitude larger, or 5.4, I'm sorry. One magnitude larger than the deep earthquake. So if it's a deep 4.4, it could go up to 5.4 to be striking here. I guess technically this is East Timor. Or is that west of East Timor? How confusing can we get? West of East Timor, or South Indonesia, right here at the bend in between the two earthquakes. Now we're going to go over further to the west and take a look at this. We have our letter V where Mount Sinabung is. Sinabung normally erupts. Sinabung hasn't erupted, which means there's a growing seismic threat. And luckily, the seismic threat for Sinabung, or around Sinabung, is actually moving to the north. We have to find our halfway point between this 4.5 and all the way up here where the 4.9 is at our letter D. And the halfway point is going to be the spot to be hit by the next earthquake. So if we find our halfway point between the two zones, not as the crow flies, but as the fault bends, it brings us back into Myanmar. So Myanmar is the central point. Myanmar is the fulcrum point. It is going to be hit by a combined total. That's an earthquake from this past week. Hold on. Let me get that off there. Okay. Myanmar is going to be hit by a combined total between the two. 4.9 on one side, 4.5 on the other equals 5.1. So 5 to 5.1. So be on watch for the 5.0 earthquake to be striking in Myanmar pretty soon. Next 2 to 3 days, tops. Now let's get into the United States. Let's talk about what's going on with us. We took the California coast down to a watch for the next few days, and we canceled the warning since no 5.0 activity, 4.0 activity, or even upper 3.0 activity struck off the coast of California at all. And it's gone completely quiet. There hasn't been any activity striking off the coast of California at all. Instead, all of Southern California has been pushed. And we'll get into the earthquakes down in Southern California. We'll look at the locations. We're going to show you guys the volcanoes being hit. We'll get into Canada and Vancouver and the slow slip event as well. But I'd like to talk about the two largest earthquakes of the day that struck in the Midwest. And we'll talk about why these got struck. You'll see we saw a rare 3.4 break out in northern Kansas. This is in Mankato, Kansas, depth of 14 kilometers. That's interesting. Let's go look it up, see if there's anything of interest there. And this will be the first time I've looked up this location myself, so bear with me as I inspect the area to see if there's anything nearby of any importance. And it's a rare earthquake to begin with, and it's on the northern edge of the craton. There's only one thing that's been new or introduced in here in the past several months. It's fracking operations that Kansas has started. Now, I don't know if that's what we're going to be looking at here or if these are just gravel pads of some kind. I would have to inspect the area to really know. Okay, we've got pumping operation here. That one's not in use. Let me see if I can find one in use. I know I've got some marked here. Okay. Here's a good example, just what they look like from above when they're in use. So here, they'll clear out a pad, they'll use it for a while, they'll move it, and here's what we've got. I mean, they're so hard to find. You really, and there's no thing we can download to get these. So you know, to get them, you literally have to be able to spend days zooming in and out on these things to find the nearby wells. So, okay, we've got an apparatus inside of one, another one that's been cleared off, but somewhere in this field here, there'll be another one nearby like what we just looked at. The only question is where. And I don't have the time on the live stream to show it to you. But anytime we see something within 5 miles, 10 miles, we start to see pumping operations. This imagery date is as of 2014. And in 2015 is when they authorized a whole bunch of new pumping and drilling to be done up in North Kansas. So I'm really wondering, once they refresh the imagery date here, the most recent I have is 2014, that we'll probably find out that there's a bunch of pumping operations that have been done here in the past 2 years. It's speculation on my part, but it's justified speculation based upon how fast they're going with this stuff. So to see a rare earthquake there just makes me again wonder, where's the nearest pumping operation? Somebody else will find it, I guarantee you. Somebody else, one of my intrepid viewers, will come on to Google and, you know, I'll get place marks sent to me by tomorrow or something that show me the operation. Again, I don't want to waste too much of your time showing to you. You're just going to have to trust me. There's something there. There's one in the county to the south. We've had previous earthquakes here over the past year or so, and they've picked up when the drilling picks up. Now, let me show you a similar sized earthquake struck just to the south, just a little bit after. So, you know, just proof that the fracking operations are moving. Let me show you this, which does have a valid picture on it. This is going across Kansas, right across into Oklahoma border. And here we go. So in Oklahoma, we have many more of these. And these are, you know, again, much better examples. A cleared out pad, an oil pumping operation, oil and gas. And these are parts where they've drilled down into the crust by thousands of feet. And then they inject water to extract natural gas and oil. And these, well, pressurized tubes, you could consider them, become vulnerable to earthquake pressure, seismic pressure, coming from the West Coast. Now, let me show you what kicked this all off. We go back 6 days. Go back 6 days into 7 days, and a 4.1 struck up here, just off the coast of Canada. Part of the overall slow slip event that's happening up to the Northwest. Also, a 4.0 struck along the San Andreas Fault south of San Francisco. Additionally, a 5.7 struck down to the south in the Gulf of California. All of that pushed to the east and caused a 4.1 at the fracking operations in Oklahoma. Now look what hit. The earthquakes in white are the ones that struck today. Those are a result of the pressure coming in from the northwest. How do we know that for certain? Well, over the last day and a half, look what happened at Yellowstone. Incoming pressure down the edge of the craton. Look which way our arrow points. Look at the spots that were hit all the way up the coast. And I would like to point out to my Canadian viewers, the east coast of Canada, southeast Quebec, is your earthquake zone. It's a spot where you need to be on watch, almost like the people over in Vancouver, because sometimes the seismic pressure reaccumulates up here to the east-northeast, just north of the North American border. You can see right here we have New York, New Hampshire, Vermont, Maine, right across this region. Whenever there's large earthquakes in the Midwest, it actually picks up here to the north. And we've seen fours and even a couple fives or near fives strike up here. Remember back in 2011, many people weren't paying attention back in 2011. After Japan got hit and the West Coast got hit of the United States, then we saw activity go up to the northeast and strike up in southeast Quebec. Those aren't pumping operations. That's eastern craton edge movement. Proof that pressure transfers across the plate. And you can even see the split. See this? Kind of like goes around and curves. That's the split in the edge of the craton. It's defined. That's not a human-made channel, guys. That is a split in the edge of the plate, miles across. Half the size of Nova Scotia across. That's how big that is. So ultimately, where's the pressure coming from? It's coming from the West Coast. And we need to take a look at the smaller earthquakes to determine what's going on the West Coast, what should be striking, what happened to the 5.8 that I was looking for, and other information that we can determine by looking at the smaller earthquakes. So I've told you guys in the past that whenever we see Northern California start to swarm out, that's when we have a sign of a coming earthquake off the coast. And I told you guys last night that sometimes, that when I miss an area, it might be a couple days, but usually within a couple days, something does strike. It's just I'm off by a day or two, and it's an earthquake forecast strike for me on the time, but then the actual magnitude we're looking for hits. Well, now the signs are there, where they weren't there even last night. And I showed it to you last night, and now you can see it tonight. The difference is Northern California swarming out, and I need to show you these locations. We really need to show them to you. So let's go look up. Let's start with the 2.0 up at the Nevada border. See how it says 66 kilometers east-southeast of Lakeview, Oregon? Let's consult the USGS map. Look, it's in Nevada. That should raise your eyebrows right there. So they're giving you an Oregon address for a Nevada earthquake. Why? Well, let's go look it up. Let me show you what's there. Why is there a swarm breaking out here all of a sudden? Well, I've told you guys about this location before if you're a longtime viewer, but we'll just show it to you. Bittner Butte and Blowout Mountain are there. So Bittner Butte, shown it so many times. Here it is. One more time. We'll zoom in right in on the tuft. We've got a tuft on top of old weathered black basalt. And then we have obsidian and basalt spread out across an old lava flow that may have even formed sometime when this was underwater. So you can see it from far away. And then I'm going to zoom in on a obvious lava flow on the perimeter of it that's been exposed. Take a look at that. Okay, so it's that again speaks for itself. And it's right next to Blowout Mountain, which is the greater volcano of the region. So let me find that here. Hold on, sorry, I'm getting dizzy. Okay, yeah, there's Blowout Mountain. And this is much more obvious. I mean, people, you know, who observe volcanoes just gradually or casually, I should say, they would even see that. Okay, so two different volcanoes at the location, and each volcano being hit right next to it with a little bit of a swarm. Now let's go further down to the south. Let's go to the southwest, down to the 1.2. McLeod, California. McLeod. There can be only one McLeod. What you're experiencing now is called the quickening. I'm Sean Connery, but I'm supposed to be a Spaniard. Why do I sound like a Scottish Spaniard? Okay, we are right on the flank of Mount Shasta. Right on it. Okay? So right on the flanks of Mount Shasta, it's pretty obvious, and we're right at the foot of Mount Shasta. And Mount Shasta erupted 100 years ago. So you guys may not know about Mount Shasta, but it's not Mount Shasta. Which one erupted 100 years ago? Lassen. Lassen erupted 100 years ago. Mount Shasta is considered an active volcano still. That's what it is. So Smithsonian marked. Take a look at it. You guys are welcome to pause it and read it. It hasn't erupted in a long time. But, again, small earthquakes striking on the flank of Mount Shasta. Volcano. Let's go further down to the south. Down to the 2.2 at North Sacramento Valley. This is right at the tip of the valley. I don't even know if that's Shasta Lake. Well, okay, that kind of speaks for itself, but let's go pull up the coordinates. We're just going to look each one up, guys. I want to prove it to you that these are all volcanoes. Flanks of Shasta Lake. And down here at Shasta Lake, let's see, where is the nearest? Here it is. Right across town, literally right across the valley, Black Butte Cone. And this is part of a volcanic field. I'll show this to you. The volcanic field is actually much bigger. So Black Butte Cone, there it is, all sides. And the greater volcanic field extends over to the east and down to the south and up to the north. And I would dare say it's probably filled in here as well, but much more ancient. So they don't have any marked volcanoes in there while they probably should. Here's another one, Inskip Volcanic Buttes. These are multiples. Look at that. Like a five-capped butte with a lava flow. And remember how I told you how the trees will cling to the lava flow. Soap Butte mixed in with there, another little small butte volcano. Oh, look, they got a little mining operation going there, exposing the cinders on another small set of buttes there. Look at that. Okay, so we've got red cinder exposed. We've got black cinder exposed. They are mining out the center of that ancient volcano. It's probably loaded with some kind of mineral or gold of some kind. And it's part of the Lassen Volcanic Center. Now, our younger lava flows are over to the east, but this is not getting struck by earthquakes right now. The older volcanoes are over, again, by Shasta Lake. So, okay, let's go further to the south. Let's carry on. All right, let's go down to the 2.0, Chester, California. Notice the USGS not showing us, not letting us know that these are in volcanic in nature. Each one of these ancient magma chambers is being perturbed right now. So Chester. Oh, well, look, we are on the edge of the southern point of the same volcanic field. And again, within the same distance. So, oh, look, the ice caves. The ice caves are right there. Oh, wow. Well, there's Lassen itself. And right on the flanks of Lassen, you can even make out the old lava. Look at the old lava flows that are here. Do you see how this, like, the shape on this goes down to the south? These are old lava flows. Black Cinder Rock, Bonte Peak Volcano, ancient. Never going to erupt again, guys. So this is not a worry of yours. You shouldn't have. We're not looking at an eruption at most of these. We're looking at seismic pressure letting us know that an earthquake is coming off the coast. How big? We have to add up the total of all the earthquakes that we see across Northern California, Central California, and Southern California. You add up the total, it's going to give you, again, the rough estimate of what should be striking off the coast to the northwest. And most of these, as I proved to you, going down to the south so far, are striking at volcanoes themselves. I can name off the other areas to save you time if you guys don't want to, you know, waste all your night looking up volcanoes. I'll just tell you, the 1.3 striking at the north of Pyramid Lake, which has a geyser field there. It's an ancient volcano at the north and western portion of Pyramid Lake. Go look it up on Google Earth. Aurora Crater, Aurora Peak, and Mud Springs Volcano all being struck right here to the south. I'm highlighting them in blue. And then one earthquake striking down to the south at Tahoe. Further to the south, we get all the way down to South Long Valley. Oh, I'm sorry, I skipped over Mammoth Mountain also being struck by a new swarm of earthquakes. And then down to the south of Long Valley, Volcano Peak and the Coso Volcanic Field struck by a swarm of earthquakes. Fact check me on each one, guys. Then we get over into South Nevada, and this is one that I find most people just don't believe. Every time I've shown it, someone either sends me a message or says something about it. I'm going to show it to you. There's a swarm breaking out at this spot in southern Nevada, and the reason it's hitting is because seismic pressure has inundated the whole coast. See how this says Skull Mountain Volcanic Buttes? Well, we're not so much concerned about the volcanic buttes. What's right next to it is the famous town that's named Doom Town, where they blew it away with a nuclear bomb. You remember, you may have seen footage of it for the people dressed in 1950s. They had mannequins in the houses, and they had a full subdivision and all that other stuff built. They blasted this town away with surface nuclear detonations. And then up to the north in the valley, they've done all the, or not all of them, but hundreds of them, underground nuke tests. And the way we know these are not just regular aerial bomb drops of any kind, you can come over and turn on the Google Earth Gallery, where people have taken such painstaking time to research each nuclear detonation and provide the name of each one, like the random one I just clicked on, Templar. Oh my God. Templar, really? March 24th, 1966. a 0.37 kiloton nuke. Shelbourne, 13th of May, 1988. 15 kiloton. So each one of these. Now I want you to imagine what happens when you do this many underground tests. Of course, it's going to fracture the crust, and it's like a broken piece of ice floating on a lake, or broken pieces of ice, and this is part of the plate there. And so pressure comes in, and it hits these spots, and it releases at these spots. But it lets us know there's a great amount of pressure coming in. It's hitting the volcanoes. It's hitting the, I haven't even talked about the pumping operations, which I'm going to talk about next. The next big stack of earthquakes here at Clear Lake Volcano at the geothermal pumping operations at Geysers, California. And we can select any one of these earthquakes. It'll tell you, well, here, I'll show you. Copy, paste. I like to prove it to you. I don't want people to you know, think I'm exaggerating. Each one is either a volcano, a pumping operation, or a man-made operation of some kind that's being hit at this point. We have just a little bit of fault zone movement. So here we are. Now you see we're next to a false 9.9 earthquake that was reported. But we're not worried about any false earthquakes. Here we go. This is a geothermal station. They pipe this. These pipelines are connected to points where they've drilled down into the volcano at these different points. It then steams off. Steam goes up to the turbine, turns the turbine, and provides power. And they've done this on the flanks of Clear Lake Volcano, which you can see here. Clear Lake is marked by the Smithsonian, and that is the former caldera of the volcano. So that spot's being struck. Then we get down into Central California, and we should go right here. Let's go look this up. It's called Huron, California. Well, let's go see what's there. Told you guys, pumping operations start moving. These are your warning signs. This lets you know something's going down. Something's coming. And again, your volcanoes start moving, then your pumping operations, then you see an earthquake strike off the coast. And let's show you where we are in California. See Huron right there? Now, our biggest pumping operation in California is just a few farm fields over to the west, definitely close enough to be related. Huge. And when I say huge, I'm not exaggerating. We'll let this image load, and I'll bring it in at an angle so we can see it go off into the distance. And at this altitude, it just looks like, you know, it just looks like some roads or something, right? Okay, we'll zoom in a little bit more. And you're gonna see, you're gonna start to make these out. Every single little black mark here is a different... What, did I just lose connection? No, okay, sorry, I just got a message. I may have just lost connection. All right, so yeah, each well showing up here as a black shadow, and it depends on which way you look at this to see the oil wells, but it just goes on for miles, and it doesn't just stop there. It goes over to the east, and sometimes in some instances they're mixed in with the farm fields, not for water pumping but for oil extraction. So we get more over here to the east, and it just keeps on going and going, and then we get right into the crops. And again, I found them in the crops. You guys are welcome to come down and check that. All the way down to the south, they're mixed in. And it makes sense. I mean, you know, depending on what they're growing here, the pipeline, this is not for watering. This is for oil and gas here. Look, you can even see the oil well there. Okay, so oil pumping inside of the crop growing. And that's not good, in my opinion, when you start getting earthquakes there. Then we get down to Southern California. And we're all around the LA Basin at this point, going literally across the LA Basin, going down towards the San Andreas Fault itself, north of Salton Sea. This is a cluster, standing out as a cluster. It's centered around the area, and it's topped out in the 3.5 range a couple days ago. If you go look a couple of the locations up, which you're welcome to go do, guys, you're going to find pretty much the same thing. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Just like what we were looking at there, you get down here along the eastern side of the LA Basin. And what do we have? Take a look. Right next to the San Andreas, guys. Now, you want to tell me what's going on here? I'd say it's not a good idea to be doing this next to one of the largest faults in the world, extraction or injection of any kind. And look, it's right next to your reservoir. So, large oil and gas extraction operation. Maybe I can get a better view on some of these pumps. There we go. There you go. So, earthquake striking there and over to the east. Then going down to the south, just northwest of Salton Sea. And that's affiliated with the San Andreas Fault itself. And then the only other earthquakes I haven't talked about are 4 or 5 small microquakes occurring across the North San Andreas going into downtown San Francisco, right on the peninsula, and I mean right at the harbor. So small quakes occurring after all that, just a few fault zones, but mostly magma chambers, mostly man-made pumping operations, or man-made fractures like the nuke ops. The other locations to be hit, the only other locations to be hit, was Yellowstone, up to the north, by the way. Yellowstone was struck by another moderate swarm. And a few connecting earthquakes in between, which are a few volcanic fields out in Utah. In case you're not familiar with Utah and the volcanic fields of Utah, let me just show you. There's so many out here, but let's match it up. Okay, so we get in southwest Utah. You see where this 1.2 is? Okay, let me get our coordinates on it so we can be accurate. Junction, Utah. We'll see how close this is, but I already can tell you it's very close. It'll be within, you know, miles. One more second here. There we go. Okay, so we are right here. Black Mountain Volcanic Butte. Nearest one. Black Mountain. Yeah, look at that. Look at that. Well, I bet that was impressive. That had to fracture under pressure at some point. Probably an earthquake came with that, and then an eruption. Not just one or the other. Oh, look, the Markagunt Plateau. Of course. How could I forget about that? The Markagunt, and this is Smithsonian Mark, but we'll just go ahead and show you some of these lava flows. Glass flows, lava flows. Here's Miller Knoll. You guys can see that. And our lava flows are pretty impressive. They're several hundred feet high and not all covered with trees yet. Take a look at that. We got a street level right next to it. I wonder if we can see a street level. You guys want to take a street level? Let's go see. Let's go see. What do these volcanic fields look like from the road? Oh, wow. Look at that. Now imagine what that was like at some point in the past. Look, you guys remember the Bárðarbunga lava flow over in Iceland where it was rolling across the landscape and the people were there taking pictures? Look at this. Imagine what this was like. Doesn't even have any trees growing on it, but that lets you know what the old hardened basalt and igneous rock, obsidian, it's kind of like a conglomeration of all of it. And let's see if we can go up any higher and get a view over the range. Wow. Well, there's no shortage of lava rock. If you guys want to start a lava rock grinding business for gardening, you can definitely have your pick. Look at that. And that's just one of them, guys. It goes on and on for miles and miles. And that's just one of them. So I love looking at this stuff. Look at that. Look how far that goes. That's just one. And the Markagunt Plateau goes on for 100 square miles in each direction. And so we have an earthquake striking on the perimeter of the Markagunt. Okay, well, that definitely fits in. Markagunt Plateau being hit, and then Yellowstone. All inside the park, right outside the park going to the west, and the magma chamber is 11 Grand Canyons in size, so it's no shock there. Now, the Northwest. Let's tackle this beast. Let's talk about it. The slow slip event, guys. The slow slip event going on in the Northwest. And at this point, I'd like to open up a copy of John Vidali's Pacific Northwest Seismic Network. And this is invaluable. Using this, I recommend that you guys check out their site, go over, use it as much as possible, take a look, go back a month, and compare the earthquakes over the last month. Let me do this. Let's go back a month. It's going to take a minute, but this is worth it. So let's go back to the 4th. What? That's like April 4th? Whoops. March. Let's select March 3rd then. We'll select March 3rd. Okay, perfect, perfect example. March 3rd, they don't have any earthquakes reported up to the north. Only a little cluster down here in California marked with these red earthquakes down to the south. So they're saying no earthquakes on the 3rd. Let's go to the 4th. None reported. 5th, none reported. 6th, several reported, again, down in California. 7th, California. 8th, nothing reported. 9th, nothing reported. 10th, nothing reported. 11th, California again. 12th, nothing. 13th, nothing. 14th, I mean, what is going on here? Well, this just doesn't fit, guys. Are you kidding me? What happened to all the earthquakes? We're at the end of March. They have a few showing up on... Oh, my God. Are you serious? You guys have tuned in with me. Well. Okay. Wrong year. What? Oh my God. How did that happen? Thank you. Okay. All right. Wrong year. Wrong year. How did I miss that? Oh, 2016. Okay. Hey guys. Hey, you know what? I'm just a guy. I'm just a man. All right. Let's try this over. Let's go to March. Let's go to March 2nd, 2017. Okay. I was, okay. Shame. Scientific shame. Okay. Okay. We're all entitled to make a mistake every once in a while, aren't we? Right, Fukushima people? Okay, there we go. Let's start over. Let's go back to the site. Go over to John Vidali's site, check it out, and make sure to check the date before you go forward. Now let's go forward. 3-2-2017. My God. Oh, sorry, guys. All right. So here we go. 3-3-3-4. Okay, now this is starting to make a little bit more sense. 3-5, take a look at it. 3-6, nothing reported, and I think they were down for a couple days. I know they were down for a couple days. 3-10, 3-11, 3-12, 3-13, nothing. 3-14, nothing. 3-15, nothing. 3-16, nothing. 3-17, nothing. At 3:18, it shows up. Okay. 3:18, it shows up. 3:19, it goes north. I can't trust this information, man. I'm turning it off. I can't trust this information. It's different than what we showed you the past couple nights, even with me changing the dates back, guys. I'm not going to show it to you until I can feel confident in the information. I'm not going to quote it to you if that's what's happening. You guys have been on the past couple nights. Now it's saying 3:18, 3:19, there weren't any earthquakes. When it's the middle of the slow slip event, and it was all down around the Olympic Peninsula. We saw it. We seen it on that time in mid-March. There was a large swarm occurring here off the eastern coast of Olympic Peninsula. It was all the way across the peninsula. Now it's showing nothing there. And that's the right date selected. I don't know what to make of it, man. This is frustrating, man. It's frustrating because now it's not just a mistake I made. There's something not right there. You guys know there was a bigger swarm happening there over those dates. So if it's not showing that, then I'm just not going to show it. So we need to watch. We need to watch and wait, and I don't know how long, because I can't rely on the information. Now, I've made mistakes like what I just did with selecting the wrong date, but you saw it. That's not the wrong date selected. It's literally showing no earthquakes on those days. And so there, I don't know why, technical error, whatever. Until I can rely on that and technically bring it to you and show you a progression over days. What I was trying to show you is that the earthquakes progressed from the Olympic Peninsula up into Vancouver Island. That's all I was trying to show you. I showed you just last night, and it had no problem doing it. But now it's not there. So that being said, now that it's not there, I can't show it to you progress from the Olympic Peninsula up into Vancouver. All I can tell you is that it's happening across the island of Vancouver right now. So Vancouver Island being hit by a swarm of earthquakes, and the swarm of earthquakes will eventually be followed by a larger earthquake that should be, by my estimation, in the 6 to 6.5 range. But we missed the 5.8 down here off the west coast entirely. So what does that mean? Well, it means no earthquake struck, or they didn't report it. I don't know which would be, but no earthquake struck. So I would add in that 5.8 to the potential of what's going to strike off the slow slip, not get rid of it. I'm still watching for it because energy doesn't just disappear. And according to many people, 4 and 5.0 earthquakes are fairly common off the West Coast, and we haven't seen one in many weeks' time, which means we're overdue. Wish I could just get on there and show it to you. It's been such a cluster trying to get on there and show it. I don't know why. That's the weird part, and it's not anything I'm doing wrong. I was able to do it last night, flip through the days, and each set of days was showing the progression of earthquakes throughout March going up into Vancouver Island. Now I'm reading chat. See, the other site, the TUNC ESS Washington Real Time, let me check that one again. But hold on. I'm getting real sidetracked here, but it's worth it if it'll work. This will show us the last 48 hours. Here, let's do that. Let's look at the last 48 hours. Okay. This will show us the last 48 hours, but it's not going to show us the progression. I guess I could. I mean, it'll show the last 3, 6, 12, 24, and 48 hours. And then I'm sure there's a way to search dates too on here probably. But, okay, 48 hours. You see where it is. It's central, south central Vancouver Island is where the slow slip has transferred to. A few earthquakes progressing down to the south at this point, two to the north of Seattle, two to the west of Victoria, and two to the northwest, or three to the northwest of Victoria. So when I see this, this means to me that the slow slip event moving further to the northwest, yesterday it encompassed the whole southern portion of the island, southern one-third, now it's centering in a cluster around central south Vancouver. How long is it going to stay there? It's going to keep reaching to the north. It's already progressed from down here at the Olympic Peninsula up here. I want to measure that, the distance from where this is. Let's again get a good idea of just the central point on this swarm and measure the distance. Okay. How far has it moved in the last 2 to 3 weeks? Coming out of the area west of Seattle, this is where the swarm started. In the, I guess, the Puget Sound west of Seattle near Bremerton. Maybe even as far south as Tacoma, but we'll put it at Bremerton to give it a few miles. So slow slip started there, and it's progressed all the way up here, 140 miles. Let's match up the locations, make sure they're spot on here. Okay, yeah. I mean, that's just to the central part west of Nanaimo. All right, yeah, that's like roughly 140 miles in kilometers. That's 228 kilometers distance traveled by the slow slip event over the past couple of weeks. That's how far of a distance has slipped. What's going to happen? Eventually, this is going to creep out and around, and I think keep going to the north. The slow slip is going to keep slipping until it hits a snag point. When it hits the snag point, when it bottlenecks, when it doesn't flow anymore out of the region, that's when the earthquake's going to strike. But how many days is that going to take? It's already gone on for weeks at this point. 5 weeks, 6 weeks. Well, they say the longest slow slip event that they've, you know, kept track of was like 6 or 7 weeks long. Well, this is going on one of the longest then. And it's so many thousands of earthquakes across 150 miles. Imagine what that adds up to it's got to add up to at least a 6 to 6.5 to be striking just to the perimeter of the area that's currently slow slipping. So if this is slow slipping down west of Nanaimo, and the Olympic Peninsula already slipped, and that whole region has, then the area to the north should compensate, which puts us at north of Vancouver Island, south of, Hecate Strait? Queen Charlotte Island? Queen Charlotte Sound? South of there, north of Vancouver Island, is the spot where I would look for the movement to strike out to sea. 6 to 6.5. And I'm watching for it. If, you know, it's going to take a long time. There's no way around that. So I'm glad we were able to at least just get that information. Man, that gets a little frustrating, not being able to pull the info, messing it up, and then finding out that you can't see it due to some technical issue. There's only one other location that we need to talk about in detail tonight, and that's here in Europe. And we talked about watching in Italy in particular for a 4.5 type earthquake to strike very soon. And it's been a couple days, and there hasn't been any larger activity. However, we did see a 2.8 to 3.0 strike back at central Italy. Over to the east is what I want to draw your attention to right now. It lets us know what's coming. We have a new swarm of fours, 1.4 breaking out at the western Turkey Peninsula, another 4 downgraded to 3.4, striking in between Italy and Greece. If you add in the other earthquakes back behind all this, this is telling the tale, something bigger is coming into the region. So first things first, Italy, by tomorrow night, you should have been hit. So you have maybe 24 hours to go on this 4.5 warning. It may go larger than 4.5. Why would it go larger than 4.5? Well, we go back a few days. Let's turn back on our USGS last 7-day feed. Go back a few days. Look down to the south. Do you see all this? Do you see all these fours and a few fives over the past several days to your east? It's obvious. You are overdue. The Mid-Atlantic Ridge hasn't been hit in 4 or 5 days, meaning everything here that's backed up can be added together. Now let's add it all together. So if we're already looking for a 4.5, so let's justify that. Let's add these together. 4.2 plus a 4.2 or a 4.0. There was two detections on that. Let's go with the 4.2 since it's two 4.2s. So 4.2 plus a 4.2 is a 4.32. So just drop off the last little decimal and it's a 4.3. Now let's add in the other 4.3 to the east. That takes us to 4.43. Drop off the decimal, and then we're at a 4.4. Also, add in the 4.3 back behind that. Now we're at 4.5. Okay? And then we're getting back far enough over into the Mideast that these other two fives just occurred in the past day. Those are going to push in the next couple days. So if you take the fours and add them together, that's the total of what's coming into Italy. Ironically, but separately, that's what we're looking for based upon the movement coming already. So does that make sense? You add up the earthquakes that you see to your east, that dictates what's coming into Italy. And it should be within the next day. Shouldn't be that long. Secondly, we have a new round of earthquakes that struck today. And you see those on the map here now. So the 4.9 and the 5.1 back here. Add the 5.1 plus the 4.9, it's basically a 5.2. It means in the next 3 to 4 days, there's going to be a new 5.0 earthquake striking between Crete and Turkey. So a very small little area. Crete is the island here. Turkey is right here. So it's a small area to watch, and it should be in the 5 range, 5 to 5.1. Once that strikes, it should push back into Italy, and it may cause up to a 5 again in Italy. So I'm looking for a 4.5 in Italy. If it goes larger, I'm sorry. If it goes up to 5 in Italy, I'm sorry. It will be based upon all those 4s that were coming in. So you may get off just under 5 in Italy right now. But in the next several days, after the 5 hits down near Crete, then I will be elevating your watch level again in Italy. Okay, so, you know, it's not that big of a deal. A mid-range 4 to 5.0 earthquake in Italy is just enough to shake things up and to catch your alarm. But it's been a while, so I don't want you to panic. But that's why the reason you're going to be hit is because of the fours all downrange from you, uprange from you, coming down towards you. Now, we did see a new 3.0 earthquake and a micro swarm break out at Gibraltar in South Spain, and another 3 strike out at our X marks the spot, just to prove to you that 3s travel in pairs and travel out across the plate, get a similar sized earthquake along the red lines. So I'm not shocked to see a 3 at the Azores after a 3 at Gibraltar with a little swarm of zeros or whatever. Ultimately, it's a lot of activity to talk about. Tonight's update took a long time because we have a lot of activity going on. And Central America, South America, your eruptions have taken care of your seismic pressure for right now. And let me quickly jump over and show this to you, and we'll end the update with this South American portion. Now we'll go back over to Volcano Discovery, show you the volcano list. Now we have many usual suspects on the list, and these are the ones that show up on a daily basis with new volcanic ash advisories. But look at who else we have on the list. So Sabancaya, usual suspect, but Turrialba's back on the list. Also, Santa Guido is on the list. And Nevados del Ruiz is on the list. Multiple times. So I'd like to show you where those are. Santa Guido volcano is here in Guatemala next to our letter V, more over to the east. So just to the east of our letter V. And then further down to the south, Turrialba volcano is right here in Costa Rica. And then further to the south, right next to our earthquake, is Nevados del Ruiz in Colombia. Well, that's a lot of activity in Central America. Then we skip over a whole region where there's no earthquakes and no eruptions today. And that's across North Peru and Ecuador. But we get down to the south and we have a new eruption here at Sabancaya, multiple new eruptions. So this spot in between our two sets of eruptions is under serious stress. And that means Ecuador, North Peru, you guys need to be on watch. You need to be on watch for a combination of the total amount of eruptions on both sides. And each eruption equals about a 5.0 earthquake. So let's say there's 5 to the north and at least 4 blasts to the south. That alone right there is taking us up into an upper 5, mid-range to upper 5. So at the low end, it should be a mid-range to upper 5 that strikes here at the central fulcrum point between the volcano to the south here and the volcano to the north here where the earthquake is. And the halfway point between these two zones just so happens to bring us down south of Reventador volcano in Ecuador. Furthermore, Central America in between the volcanoes is going to start moving. And Mexico, you're going to see some new blasts at Colima and at Popo. Now, those are your two relief points. When they stop erupting, you start to see earthquakes. So you hope for some small blasts, moderate blasts, that'll relieve that pressure. But your volcanoes to the south are going. That means those two suckers are going to go as well. They're marked with letter Vs. They're both going to move. And a more rare 3.0 earthquake struck there. Again, a sign that incoming pressure. This is all due to that M-class flare. The M-class flare from a few days ago is finally starting to impact Earth. It takes 2 to 3 days for it to get here. And then the solar wind in the days before that, also pretty much a sign, guys, that the pressure is increasing. Oh, look. Look at what we have here. Hey, for my people down under. Good day. Are you listening? Take a look. People down under. Another earthquake just struck here, right in the middle between our two previous earthquakes. Similar in size. Good day. Good day. And this is proof again that the pressure spreads out around the plate as one would expect after you push up on the underside. As I'm talking here now, a 3.0 earthquake has struck on the San Andreas Fault. Or no, this is the Hayward Fault. That's San Francisco. San Francisco, you probably felt that. I bet there's some people that live in San Francisco that felt that. Let's go see if it's really a 3. Oh, that's not even being reported on the USGS site yet. Is that right? Hold on. Wow, things are picking up again. Hey, you know what? Towards the end of these updates, sometimes this happens. This happens sometimes. Hold on. Let's go see. No, that's not it. Is that it? No. Let's go take a look and go see for ourselves. San Francisco Bay Area. USGS says it was a 0.8, man. Says it was a zero. Look at all the zeros they got on their list. More like a 3.1, guys. Oh. USGS says it's 2.9. Let's go to there. Hey, look, they just deleted it. They just deleted it. Dun, dun, dun. Just deleted. Here's the link, guys. Let's go look it up. Where are our coordinates? Here we go. What do we have here? What do we have at the location that we are trying to hide? Who lives here? Right? What is here? Fairchild Semiconductor Corporation. What? IBM Research. It's at the IBM Research Facility. Dun, dun, dun. Hide it. Hide it. Get it out of there. Yes, sir. Hide. Activate the robots. Oh, boy. All right. Wow. Okay. Much love, guys. Oh, this is grand. This is grand. All right. So tonight was fun. Tonight was fun. That all being said, I want to encourage you to have an earthquake plan and be prepared. If you live in Japan, for instance, we're looking on the coast of Honshu. This is a time to take it serious. That we're looking for in the 6 range. If I am off by 100 miles and it strikes on land as opposed to out to sea, it'll make a big deal for you. It'll knock things off shelves. If it strikes in the middle of the night, you might not be prepared for it. Everybody will freak out and think something bigger is coming when it's not. And you just need to let them know that it's a result of the deep earthquake and the pressure coming up from the south, from Guam and Philippines. Look what's coming your way. Look which way the arrows point. Look what's coming your way. Find the halfway point between the two zones. That's the spot that's going to be hit. It takes the fear out. You can see what's coming your way, like a storm coming your way. As for the other areas, our silent zones that we talked about, those areas are going to be hit. It's just a matter of a couple days, 2 to 3 days at the most. As we look in the northwest United States, this is where we get more drawn out. This is where I don't know how long it's going to go. It's the, how many licks does it take to get to a center of a Tootsie Pop? 1, 2, crunch 3, and it, you know, all it's going to take is a new amount of pressure coming in from the northwest that's great enough to send that slow slip into the one single release that compensates for all that movement that's occurred over the past several days and weeks. If you live in the Midwest U.S., right now, you should listen up if you live in the Midwest. Look, you guys can still make some choices in Nebraska, maybe even in Kansas, in Iowa, and other states that are considering doing fracking, doing the extraction, doing the injection. You guys, if you're gonna continue doing it, you have to be willing to accept the consequences of the drilling, which means you're gonna be your own New Madrid seismic zone for the foreseeable future. That Humpty Dumpty breaks, you can't put it back together. You will be the new seismic risk zone. So for the people in Ohio and Pennsylvania, your leaders have decided it'd be a great idea to start doing injection. Oh, you're going to make a new fracture point on the edge of the plate and attract earthquakes to your location. Otherwise, they would normally pass underneath you and go up to the north and strike up in southeast Canada, naturally speaking. And if you step in the way, you're gonna step in the way of a train. It's pressure that can't be stopped. It's a force that's great that passes through an area along these tracks, quote unquote. And if you step on those tracks and you divert it, you gotta be willing to accept what's coming your direction. It's just that simple. So pay attention. You can still do something about it, but you're gonna have to pass laws that say that, well, if an earthquake starts, operation cut. That's just if earthquake activity starts, operations are done, no more. And no, not for a moratorium, I mean forever. Because once it starts, it doesn't stop. You can just talk to the people in Oklahoma, talk to the people in Kansas, talk to the people in Texas, talk to the people in Colorado. They've all been hit by 4 and 5.0 type earthquakes that have knocked chimneys down, facades off houses, and they can't even do anything to stop the well being drilled in their own town because they passed laws that say that people who live in their own towns can't have a say in where the wells go. So if they want to put one next to a playground, which has happened, they've got several next to playgrounds, frack wells. No problem. It's absolutely just wild. So you guys got to step up. You got to step up and let people know, look, it's not worth the billions that you get. The billions you get is not a good trade-off for becoming a seismic zone for the rest of existence. It's just not. The trade-off is not a good one. The only reason that the fracking operations in the far north Midwest, up in North Dakota and South Dakota, aren't being hit by large earthquakes is because of their location. Their location is at the center portion of the craton, which there aren't any plate boundary edges that meet up to it. So it's sitting high and dry while all the other fracking operations where you think they'd be okay aren't, because pressure transfers across the edge of the plate. Geologists didn't know this. There's a guy who made a discovery online that pressure transfers across the North American plate going this direction. That's me. And so they have to take that into account. If they don't take that into account, well, they're going to continue to get hit. And not only are they going to continue to get hit, but it's going to get worse as more humans step in and do more drilling into this edge that becomes, well, primed. It's a river of flowing seismic pressure. And you can see the river of pressure. I'll end the video here. I know I said I was going to do that 10 minutes ago. But I'll end the video here by showing you the river of pressure and what it did to the rock and to the plate over however long of a period of time. I mean, God only knows how long, but we'll zoom in on this and take a look. And turn that off and turn off our borders and labels as well so we can only see the plate. See this? See the shape of this? How it almost resembles a flowing river of, like, over a large area? These are all mountain ranges. And these mountain ranges make up the interior edge of the unsubducted craton. And it goes all the way across the United States and curls back up the mountain ranges, goes up through Colorado. This is Yellowstone right here, Yellowstone Crater. Up here to the north, following up to the north, all of our pumping operations all along the interior edge of this, guys. Thousands of pumping operations. This is Canada now, by the way. This is up in Canada. Thousands of pumping operations, oil and natural gas, just like down in the United States. So you guys, again, I'm not going to take the time to show you all the wells up here in Canada. It just goes on and on for miles. And they've figured out that along the edge of the craton is where the shale is. It just so happens that's where the seismic pressure also transfers, contrary to what geologists thought. So North Dakota, sitting up here high and dry in the middle, of course it's not going to be earthquake prone. It's sitting in the middle of the plate. But all these other locations on the edge of the plate, including Pennsylvania and the others, you shouldn't be doing it. Okay? So, but I do have an invention that I'd be willing to give away, or at least sell for a small price, to the oil companies themselves, which would expend the seismic pressure, still generate energy, and make money while they are actually stopping the earthquakes, which would then stop the groundwater pollution to some extent because of the cracking in the casements that's releasing that toxic water and gas and oil out into the shallower bedrock and water table and such. The reason there's cracks in the casement is because of earthquakes, guys. So if we can avert the earthquake by expending the pressure, that's probably the best idea. But to expend the pressure, you got to expend the gas and oil. And I've figured out a way to do that without causing any environmental damage and actually generating power, electricity, by the expending of that gas and oil. So that's good news, right? So if there's going to be an incoming amount of pressure, pressure comes in, it detects the pressure, expends the gas and oil that needs to be expended, and guess what? Guess what? No earthquake. Pressure transfers right by it and goes to the next primed well, the one that's not ready to expend the pressure. Because I've described this before. Each drilled well is like a shock absorber on your car. charged with gas and or liquid, but it's not designed to compress. So the shock absorber on your car, primed with like a scuba tank, overfilled, what happens when you put pressure on the outside of that tank? Boom! It's going to explode. And that's exactly what happens on the inside of these wells. And they fracture out and release that water and gas. So again, I'm getting sidetracked, but I just want to tell you guys, there's a solution for the problem. But you have to be willing to admit there's a problem to begin with in order to accept the solution. You know what I mean? Okay, so word up to my people. I appreciate everybody doing everything. And thank you for taking part in this and sharing the information. Please, please subscribe. I've been trying to grow my channel and they took away, what, 2,000 or 3,000 subscribers today. Don't know why. All at once, too. They weren't an unsubscription, guys. It wasn't like people coming over and clicking unsubscribe. We're talking one big unsubscription of 1,000 channels at once or more. That's impossible. You'd have to have 1,000 computers logged on at once and everybody click at once. It all happened in 1 second, which means someone at YouTube on the inside took away thousands and thousands of subscribers. Only 110 closed accounts, guys. So it's not like a bunch of closed accounts. You know, they found a bunch of, you know, old accounts and closed them or something. No, that there are 100 closed accounts in the last 30 days. They just took away thousands today for some reason, and I cannot figure out why. I'm trying my best on YouTube. I give them benefit of the doubt a lot of times, even when I shouldn't. And I've been shut off every night after I do my update, which means you guys can't rewind it and watch it. I don't even know if they've done it tonight. If they shut me off tonight, we'll have to wait and see. If they did shut me off, you can't rewind to hear my update. And that's why they shut me off. So I give them benefit of the doubt, but in this case, I don't know what to expect at this point. It's getting kind of ridiculous. Much love to everybody. I'll be back in a little while. I went to the P.O. box and got a bunch of mail that came in. And we got a very, very nice package. Somebody sent us a bunch of very, very cool things. And they instructed us to open it offline. Like, I've got stuff about St. Michael. And a pendant, a St. Michael pendant, which I am wearing. Okay, I'm wearing it. And sent to me by a viewer who wanted to remain offline anonymous. Not a problem. Not a problem. Just wanted to let you know we got it. And I've got the stuff in my office and around the house. Thank you so much for sending that. Also got stuff, a repeat letter from R.A. Or no, somebody else. Out of Glendale, California, R.A. Paula, out of Gunnison, Colorado again. No return name, out of Seattle, Washington. Lori, out of Seattle, Washington. R.A., out of Glendale, again, a second letter. And first initial C, out of Olympia, Washington. So I guess the Washington truck came in today. Also got an international pack from Canada. This came from Valemount, B.C. Valemount, B.C. Doesn't have a name on it, though. Valemount, B.C. Somebody up in B.C. I don't know if I want to open that one. Now, my wife screened the packages. We got something from Nancy out of Longview, Washington. Another package from Nancy out of Longview, Washington. And a box from Nancy out of Longview, Washington. So two packs and a box from Nancy. And then Tim and Corinne out of Yucca Valley, California. So, and, you know, again, for everybody... There were people trying to say I mail stuff to myself. Guys, postage paid. Look at the date. Look at the date. You think I'm mailing stuff to myself from California? Come on. Who would mail stuff to themselves? That's pathetic. I don't need to mail stuff to myself. I've got thousands of viewers around the planet. By the way, for the people who sent the very generous donations, I hand wrote you thank you notes on stationery sent to me by a viewer from Japan. And it's really cool. It's got little Mount Fuji's on it. And I hand wrote you thank yous and sent it back. And you're also going to be getting some dutchsinse business cards in with your thank you letters that were sent back to you. So just really, really cool stuff that you guys have. So I'll be doing an unboxing tonight after, let's say about 11, well, let's see, it's 11:30. Let's say after 12:30, let's go about 1 a.m. Central Time. I will get on and do an unboxing. We will open this stuff and see what we got from viewers. Again, this is a big West Coast haul, so maybe a truck came in from the West Coast, had a lot of stuff in it. Looks like Washington and California is what arrived, and one from British Columbia. That makes sense. Washington, California, British Columbia, West Coast probably all get put on a truck and brought.